teacher trainees. Today's lecture will be on women's education. At the end of this session, you will be able to find out the history of women's education in India, know the constitutional provisions for women and schemes given by the Government of India, state the problems in women's education and give its solutions. Let me first remind you that the basic unit of society is a woman, as she makes a family, family makes a home, and home makes a society. Women's education in India plays a key role in the social and economic development of the country. Women's education is a very long and sordid story. It has passed through ages of Vedic period, post-Vedic period, Muslim period, British period, and the modern education period. First, let us see what happened in the Vedic period. In the Vedic period, women enjoyed a high social status, but higher education was confined only to the upper class women. Ordinary girls were educated in their own homes by their fathers, uncles or brothers, or by local lady teachers. During the post-Vedic period, education of women declined. They were treated as mere property of men, and they were assigned dependent status and denied freedom and knowledge of the Vedic texts. During the Muslim period, female literacy went further down due to the parda system for common girls. Akbar set up separate chambers in Fatehpur Sikri for a girls' school and appointed some mistresses to work in it. Aurangzeb, the last Mughal ruler, showed great interest in promoting education among the royal ladies only. He himself taught his daughters. Daughters of Rajput chiefs and some Bengali zamindars were able to read and write. So during this period, only the rich Hindu and Muslim women received religious education at home. At the advent of the British rule, female education had disappeared. It was the missionaries and the private voluntary bodies, both Christian and Hindus, who became the votaries of education. So during this period, the missionaries and the private voluntary bodies helped in the upliftment of female education. They took increasing interest in the promotion of women's education in the country by setting up schools and colleges in various parts of the country and by bearing the financial burden of women's education. During this period, various socio-religious movements were led by Rajaram Mohan Roy, Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar, Mahatma Jyotiba Phule, Periyar and Baba Saheb Ambedkar, which took various initiatives to make education available to women of India. The advent of independence in 1947 brought in a new era with respect to women's education. The 20th century highlighted the reciprocal relationship between educational progress of women and their growing stature in the political and social life of the country. In spite of these advances, a wide gap remains between the percentage of men and women receiving education since independence. So, this is the history of women's education since Vedic period. Now, moving on to the constitutional provisions, there are two articles that are framed specifically for women. They are Article 14, which provides equal status to women. Article 15, Clause 3, empowers the states to take affirmative action towards women. Now, moving on to the legislations related to women's issue, we have the following special provisions to safeguard women and their interests. They are the Employees State Insurance Act 1948, the Plantation Labor Act 1951, the Family Courts Act 1954, the Special Marriage Act 1954, the Hindu Marriage Act 1955, the Hindu Succession Act 1956 with amendment in 2005, Immoral Traffic Prevention Act 1956, the Maternity Benefit Act 1961 which was amended again in 1995, Dowry Prohibition Act 1961, the Medical Termination of Pregnancy Act 1971, the Contract Labor, that is Regulation and Abolition Act 1976, the Equal Remuneration Act 1976, the Prohibition of Child Marriage Act 2006, the Criminal Law Amendment Act 1983, the Factories Act 1986, Indecent Representation of Women, that is Prohibition Act 1986, Commission of Sati, that is Prevention Act 1987, the Protection of Women from Domestic Violence Act 2005. Apart from these legislations, we also have other major schemes taken by the government to foster the growth of female education. They are Mahila Samakya Program 1988 for the empowerment of women from rural areas, especially socially and economically marginalized groups. The second one is National Program for Education of Girls at Elementary Level, that is NPEGEL, launched in 2003 to reach out to the girls who the SSA was not able to reach. That is, this program was started to help the girls whom the Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan was not able to reach. Then the third one is Kasturba Gandhi Balika Vidyalaya Scheme, which was launched in 2004 to provide education to girls at primary level. Next one is the Sakshar Bharat Mission for Female Literacy, launched in 2008 for promoting adult education, especially women. And the next major scheme is National Scheme of Incentives to Girls for Secondary Education, which was launched for the upliftment of girls from the SC or ST communities through monetary incentives for education. And the next initiative is Central Board of Secondary Education, that is CBSE Scholarship Scheme or Policy for Girl Education, where the scholarship is awarded to female students who are the only child in their families. And the next one is the Balika Samriddhi Yojana, which is a scholarship scheme for girl children and their mothers living below poverty line. And you all must have heard this popular scheme, Beti Bachao, Beti Padao, which is aimed specifically to address the sex ratio discrepancy, ensuring holistic growth and protection of girl child and providing equal opportunity for education and participation to the girl child. Apart from these major schemes, the government has also brought in some other special initiatives for women. They are the National Commission for Women, which was launched in 1992. This is a statutory body set up to study and monitor all matters relating to the constitution and legal safeguards provided for women. And the next initiative is Reservation for Women in Local Self-Government, launched in 1992 to ensure 1/3 of the total seats for women in all elected offices in local bodies, whether in rural or urban areas. Then the next one is the National Plan of Action for the Girl Child 1991 to 2000 to ensure survival, protection and development of the girl child with the main objective of building up a better future for the girl child. And the last special initiative is National Policy for the Empowerment of Women, that is 2001, to bring about the advancement, development and empowerment of women. So these are all the special initiatives and special schemes framed by the government for the protection and safeguarding women. Even after all these schemes and initiatives, there are barriers in the women's education in India. The three main problems facing women's education are high cost of education, social factors such as early marriage, etc., and discriminatory processes at work with the school system in itself. The other reasons for the wide gap between men and women's education is due to the following reasons. The reasons are poverty, unhealthy attitude towards girl education, more household work, distance of school from home, community pressure, unclean environment of school, scarcity of lady teachers, lack of segregated schools, child marriage, single teacher schools, lack of parental involvement, development of immorality, lack of social consciousness among women, financial difficulties, problem of transport, problem of co-education, and finally, lack of coordination between home, school, and life outside. So these are all the barriers for women's education. So what can be the solutions to these problems? To name a few, convergence of education, economic and health policies, development of human resources, training to enhance gender sensitivity of teachers, augmenting system of non-formal education, that is increasing the system of non-formal education, continuation and increasing the provision for adult education, especially women's education. And lastly, amalgamation of literacy campaign with other department programs, that is combining of the literacy campaigns with other department programs. These are all the solutions to break the barriers for women's education. So my dear students, by now you should have known the history of women's education, constitutional provisions and special schemes and initiatives framed by the government to empower women's education, the barriers for women's education and its solutions. Do not forget that the first and the best place of child's learning is the mother's lap. Empower women and their education. Until we meet again, take care.